Here's an interesting one. Today, let's take a look at a common question that can actually come up in both your early data structures modules in school, as well as possibly in a job interview. You know what stacks and queues are, but are you able to implement a queue using two stacks? Today, we'll walk through some of the thought processes required to actually come up with the solution. I'll also show you a little bit of code at the end just to, you know, sort of wrap everything up nicely. So yeah, that's the plan for today. You're watching another Random Wednesday episode on 0612 TV. Hello and welcome back to another Random Wednesday episode. Now, first and foremost, before we continue, I'm going to assume that you know what stacks and queues are. If you don't, or if you are, you know, sort of unsure, do check out this video that I've created some time ago. That's going to actually go in depth into what a stack and a queue is. So yeah, past this point, I'm going to assume you know your stuff. So with that said, let us jump in. Now, let's actually sort of take a closer look at this problem that we need to solve. And that is, we want to build a queue data structure, but we can only use two stacks to do it. Now, this at first glance sounds really difficult. I mean, when we actually learned about, you know, these data structures, we've always pictured them as an array of some kind. And what that means, of course, is that it's not really easy to imagine, you know, building a queue using a completely different data structure. Namely a stack, which is so much more limited than just a general array. But really, it's not as daunting as you think. After all, a queue is just a very simple data structure bounded by a set of rules. It doesn't actually say anywhere that, you know, you have to use an array or any other data structure to implement it under the hood. You can actually use any method you want. I mean, print them out on cards and sort them by hand if you want to. At the end of the day, if your data structure behaves according to the rules of a queue, it's a queue. So yeah, the point is, you're gonna have to get comfortable with that uncomfortable feeling. With that said, let's jump in to take a look at a graphical representation of what we're gonna be doing today. So okay, let's paint a picture first. This is our virtual queue, and basically we're gonna be implementing it with two stacks, namely stack in on the left, and stack out on the right. Let's try to see how this works. An enqueue operation is the simplest. We simply push it into stack in. In fact, let's go ahead and enqueue several more items. Well, they just go into stack in as you would expect. Now, the head of the queue, colored yellow here, is at the bottom of the stack. So, if we want to actually perform a dequeue operation, well, we're gonna have to do something to reveal the bottom of the stack so that it can be popped. This is the interesting operation. What we're gonna do is we're gonna have to pop from stack in and push the result into stack out. So we start off with C, then to B, then to A. This of course solves our problem because now A is at the top of a stack and can be popped right out. In fact, that is indeed what we're gonna do next. To dequeue the first item, all we have to do now is to pop from our stack out. This of course moves the head of the queue to item B, which is actually conveniently ready to pop right out of stack out. What this means is now this dequeue operation is instantaneous. B comes right out of the stack and we're ready to move on, with C being the new head of the queue. But here's the deal, instead of also dequeuing this, what we're gonna do is we're gonna actually enqueue a few more items. What's gonna happen now? What's gonna happen when we try to dequeue? As it turns out, it is still instantaneous because, well, the next item to dequeue is sitting right in the out stack. So essentially, the complexity of the dequeue operation depends on whether there are actually items inside the out stack. After C has been dequeued, the next dequeue operation is going to have to incur the expensive transferring step. And the reason for that is because stack out is now empty. Let's look at this whole problem from a different angle. Let's draw a flowchart. So of course, the first thing you need to think about is what operation you want to actually do. An enqueue operation is always easy because all you have to do no matter what the state of the stacks are, you just have to push the new item onto stack in. That's it, we return back to the beginning and wait for our next action. A DQ operation is more complex because we have to think about whether stack out is actually empty. If it is, then we'll actually have to do that expensive transferring operation. If it isn't, then we simply pop from the stack and we're done. Of course, this is something you have to do regardless of whether the stack is actually empty or not, because after you've done the transferring operation, you still have to actually remove that top item. So yeah, this particular step here has to happen regardless, and with that done, we return back to the beginning. So yeah, this is just, you know, a very quick flowchart of how we are going to implement the entire thing. So yeah, hopefully this gives you a better understanding of what we're trying to do today. As you can see, it is fairly efficient in most situations, even though at one point of time or another, well, it's going to be somewhat more complex, and that's going to take as much as O n time. Of course, that is just the worst case. In general, it's going to be better than that. With that said, let's now move on to the code. In particular, the pseudocode that's going to actually drive what we're going to do. What we're writing here is pseudocode, but thankfully, this is actually very simple to understand. So hopefully there will be no difficulty in translating this to the programming language of your choice. First and foremost, we're of course going to have to create our two empty stacks, namely stack in and stack out. Then we're going to actually implement the enqueue operation, which of course is very straightforward because it doesn't really, you know, require any condition checking. In fact, it's just a one-liner. To enqueue an item, you just push it into stack in. No difficulties here. Moving on again, let's implement the beginning of the DQ operation, and that is to check if stack out is actually empty. So usually a simple if statement. Depending on what language you're using, you may have to actually query the length of the stack instead. Though strictly speaking, that's not something you can do on stacks. Anyway, let's do the complex sort of transferring operation first. This is in fact quite simple as well. As long as stack in is not empty, what you want to do is you want to pop the item from stack in and then push it into stack out. So of course, in this case, we expect the item to be returned by the pop function, and we simply push that exact same item back into stack out. As you can imagine, the way this iteration will work is we're going to lose an item from stack in. As we loop back, we're going to check to see if stack in still has items. And so we're going to run this as many times as there are items in stack in. And yeah, this will only terminate when stack in becomes empty. Moving on, once again, we'll of course have to do our final popping step. This is yet another one-liner. We pop from stack out and return the item. And that of course completes our DQ operation. Now, actually, there is one more thing you should take care of. It is entirely possible to attempt to dequeue from an empty queue. The way we check this is to simply check if stack out is empty after you've done it the first time. Now, the reason why this works is because, of course, it's possible for stack out to be empty, even though the queue itself actually has items, but we've already handled that just now by actually, you know, popping everything out of stack in into stack out. However, there is a possibility that at this point, stack in is already empty. This will still run, but this while loop will not happen. What you get at the end of the day is, of course, an empty stack out. And that is when you know for sure that the queue itself is also empty. So of course, you will not want to run this function because you will get nothing. Instead, you want to give an error message and then continue on. So yeah, that is basically your entire pseudocode. Even though we've gone through a complex flowchart, really, in terms of code, it's just a few simple lines. So yeah, that was what it looks like in code form. Let's now actually, you know, turn it into something that can be executed. In particular, I've actually written a chunk of Python code, which we can then actually run. Now, in this particular version, I've actually implemented one extra thing, which is a little counter that tells you when you actually have to do that, you know, slower transferring operation. I've actually indicated here how many iterations have actually taken place. And as you can see, a lot of the time we don't actually incur that expensive step. Only when we've actually fully drained the out stack do we actually have to do that whole transferring operation again. So yeah, I wouldn't say this is an efficient implementation. Obviously, if you use an array, it's gonna be better, but this is as good as it gets. Anyway, that's basically it for this episode. As mentioned earlier, this is something that you might have to do, you know, either in school or even for something higher level like an interview. So it's definitely good to sort of internalize the thought processes behind doing this as early as you possibly can. I guess the reason why it's so common is that this is not something that is immediately obvious as to, you know, how you want to do it. A little bit of creative thinking is involved here, which is why, well, this is something that's good to know. Anyway, that's all there is for this particular episode. Thank you very much for watching, and until next time, you're watching 0612 TV. Thank you very much for watching. If you liked this video, consider checking out the rest of my work on my channel. Alternatively, you may be interested in a playlist of my earlier work on computing and computer science topics. If you'd like to show me some monetary support, I am on Patreon. You can find a link to my campaign in the video description. Of course, you can simply like this video or leave a comment. I'll be sure to respond as soon as I can. To keep in touch with my future uploads, do subscribe to this channel. And for even more updates, check out the official Twitter account for this channel at 0612TV. Thank you for your support.